when I look at circadian rhythm, I feel that's the best biomarker of whether you're healthy or not. Because when you think of circadian rhythm, the first thing that comes to your brain is sleep and wakefulness. For example, if you're lucky enough to have gone to bed around 10 o'clock, and if you're completely healthy and sound, then you may have uninterrupted 6 to 7 hours of sleep. So you are in bed for 8 hours and maybe you got 7 hours of sleep. And within the first couple of hours, you get what is your deepest sleep. And that's when the growth hormone spikes. And although the name is growth hormone, we actually need that growth hormone throughout our life, because every single day we damage nearly 1/10 to 1/15 of our cells. So that means our intestinal lining actually turns over every 15 days. Our skin turns over completely in every 15 days. And this growth hormone spike helps us to repair and rejuvenate at night. And then now there is new finding that when we sleep, our brain literally detoxifies. So that means there is literally, there is this glymphatic system that takes all the toxins away from our brain and drains into our lymphatic system and ultimately to our bloodstream and out. And anticipating waking up, your body temperature begins to rise, your heart begins to pump a little faster, you breathe a little faster so that you can wake up. Because waking up is a big thing for the body. Just imagine, you're just lying there without much sensation and you are into deep sleep. And waking up is a huge physiological change. And that's the reason why when daylight saving time changes and you fall back by 1 hour, that's the morning when there's a spike in heart attack, because the body was not ready to wake up. And when you force it to wake up, the heart was not ready, and you're forcing it to pump faster. And that's one reason. And this experiment has been going on for almost 100 years. And we always see on that day, there is a spike in heart attack. And after waking up, your melatonin level will begin to decline. That's the night hormone that helps you to sleep. And your cortisol, the stress hormone, spikes within an hour of waking up. And in fact, the highest level of cortisol that you will experience in the entire day happens in the morning. Even if you're going into an open heart surgery and in the afternoon, that amount of stress does not beat the morning cortisol. So the morning cortisol is, and in fact, there is a famous circadian researcher who got into research looking at this cortisol peak and realized that this is very strong rhythm that happens every single day. If you have a healthy gut, then your bowel movement is most likely within a couple of hours of waking up, and your highest insulin sensitivity, that means your ability to digest and absorb nutrient from a carbohydrate-rich diet, is much better in the first half of the day until noon. And your alertness peaks around between, say, 12 to 2 o'clock, and maybe thank you for arranging my talk around 1 o'clock. Everybody is alert. And their muscle performance and joint performance actually peaks in late afternoon, because your body has warmed up and muscles are flexible. And in fact, this is the time when we should be doing our exercise. And then hunger actually peaks in late afternoon. So it's not a big surprise that you feel hungry late afternoon. And then in the evening, melatonin rises and body cools down and you go back to sleep. And that's the healthy sign of circadian rhythm. And that healthy circadian rhythm is also the sign of good health. And then how do we dissect it? Now let's break it down and think about how to drive a good circadian rhythm so that you can live a healthy life. So if you think about it, we have an internal circadian clock, and I'll get to that. And that essentially drives three foundations of health: that's sleep, nutrition, and exercise. So it times when we should sleep, how long we should sleep. It also, if we have the healthy circadian rhythm, it also tells us when to be hungry and to be just hungry enough, not too much, so that we stop binge eating. And if we have a strong circadian rhythm, then we also have a strong, good muscle function to exercise. And we also know that when we eat, when and how much we eat affect our sleep, and nutrition affects our exercise, and exercise affects our sleep. So all these things are interrelated. And everything is also under the control of light and darkness. So sounds very complex, but I will try to break it down to just three simple ideas, because just like learning to drive, it's is pedal or gas, brake, and steer. So similarly, here there are three key ideas: light and also darkness, eat and fast, and also move and rest, when to exercise and when to rest. And if we figure out these three and adopt very well, then we can better perform during the day when we are supposed to, and at night time we can rejuvenate and repair. Just imagine, human body is not like a machine. We always say that human body is like a machine. Just take out your smartphone and think about it. Your smartphone is maximum 5 years old. If our body was like a smartphone, then in every 5 years, we had to reset our brain and then download new software and also maybe change few features. So this is the best thing we have. This is the, I think the biggest challenge to science now is to understand how the human body works. And so the best thing we can do to our body is to take care of it well. And so now let's dive into what are circadian clocks and why and how to take care of them. So circadian rhythms are controlled by what we call circadian clocks or 24-hour clocks that are present in every organ and actually in every cell in our body. So as we all can imagine that there is a clock in our brain that tells us when to go to sleep, when to wake up. Every organ, every cell in our body also has its own clock. The brain's function is to act as a master conductor so that all these clocks work together so that we have much better rhythms in physiology, our hormone level, metabolism, when we digest and absorb nutrient, behavior, our mental health, when we are calm and when we are upset, and even our gut microbiome. And in fact, the circadian rhythms are so much everywhere that if you pluck my hair and put it in a dish in a laboratory, then you'll see that my hair will grow only for 7 to 8 hours and then will stop. And then again grow and stop, again grow and stop. And this is a simple idea, but then the implication is those who are getting, unfortunately getting radiation therapy for cancer, radiation therapy in the morning will lead to loss of your hair. But then in the afternoon, when the repair function is much stronger, we have seen that the same radiation in the mice in the evening preserves 85% of their hair. So that's as powerful as that. So almost every single cell has a clock. That means you can also take my skin fibroblast, scratch it, and then culture it in the dish, and you can tell me whether I'm from this planet or Mars, because whether my clock runs at 24 hours or 25 hours. So you can even get that from my skin. And all these clocks are driven by light that's perceived only through the eyes. You might think that light can affect your skin and vitamin D, but none of that matters for clock. The only light that matters is the light that goes through the eyes. And I'll not talk about why you have a clock, but I'll give you some examples. So the function of the clock is to anticipate. So for example, I told you how before waking up, your body anticipates. So that's how you wake up. Similarly, if we have a regular breakfast time, before our breakfast, actually our pancreas, our gut, they get prepared. They secrete the right digestive juice. And so that's anticipating food the body prepares. And then synchronization and separation. So for example, your bowel movement and your sleep are separated because they're not compatible with each other. And when people break circadian rhythm or don't have a healthy circadian rhythm, or babies who are yet to develop circadian rhythm, that's when they mix up. And that's why babies can pass stool even in their sleep. So the function of the clock is to separate these incompatible processes and also synchronize them compatible processes. So for example, you should be hungry and you should be willing to exercise during the day. Just imagine in the night, if your muscle tone is much better, you'll act on your dream and you'll start sleepwalking. So that's how we synchronize, clocks help to synchronize. And repair and rejuvenation is the biggest thing that the clock does, and that's why we can repair ourselves. So during nighttime, almost every organ, every skin cell, everything repairs. Our cornea, our skin, our gut intestine, our intestinal lining, almost our entire body goes through repair and rejuvenation at nighttime. And this is mostly done by having a functional clock. I'll not go into detail, but then I'll give you one simple experiment that we did long time ago, because we really wanted to know whether everything actually cycles and what is the proof. We cannot go and take samples from humans, and we wanted to see almost every single brain region, every single organ you can think of, what actually cycles, because maybe our digestive juice turns on and off in the pancreas at the right time. But what about our heart? Maybe there is something else that turns on and off. What about our brain that makes memory? So that's why a few years ago, we did a once-in-a-lifetime experiment. We went to Nairobi, where actually Jane Goodall trained in this institute, and we collected 12 baboons and their organs and tissues in every 2 hours over 24 hours. And we asked a simple question, is there a clock in every organ? And actually, the answer is yes. So these are 64 different tissues and different brain regions, and everywhere you see, there is a spike, so that means there are a certain number of genes that turn on and reach their peak and then turn off. And this is many of the genes turn on. So for example, here the genes are turning on in the late afternoon, and here the genes in the liver are turning on in the morning or in the late evening. So the bottom line is we found nearly 85% of the genome, or almost the entire genome in a baboon, which is non-human primate, has this circadian rhythm in a tissue-specific manner. So that means certain things turn on and off at some time in the muscle, some other genes turn on and off in the digestive system. So everything cycles. And in fact, this became the primer, and now people are finding that from human biopsy samples, almost many of the findings that we found in baboon now translate. So the bottom line is, yes, things cycle, but then the question is, what do they do? And this is a little bit more biological, but if we map what those genes do in different organs, then we find almost every simple cellular process that makes every cell to be healthy, that are clock regulators. So for example, our mitochondria makes energy, but when they make energy, they also damage themselves. And the clock repairs this damaged mitochondria. So similarly, and if you think about it, defect in one or more of these processes lead to one or more of the disease. Almost every human disease, we can boil them down to one or more of these processes that go bad. And circadian, having a strong circadian clock fixes it. So as a result, having a strong circadian rhythm optimizes our immune function so that we are more resilient to infectious diseases. It optimizes repair. For example, our bones actually recycle every single day. So our osteoclast, the one that chew up some bones and that makes some bones, they also cycle, and our muscles also cycle. So our repair function is much better. Our brain function is much better, so that we have improved emotional and intellectual performance, and then optimum metabolism and detoxification helps us to be resilient against many of the chronic diseases that reduce our lifespan, so that we can stay resilient, and also we reduce our risk for cancer.